Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal and today we are going to discuss MCQs based on Yojana and Kurukshetra for the month of March 2019. So I've been taking discussions on Yojana and Kurukshetra and this is my second lesson wherein I will be taking the MCQs based on March 2019. If you have not seen the previous lesson, please do go now and watch it, because there I discuss the MCQs based on April 2019 Yojana and Kurukshetra. If you like the previous lesson and if you like the this particular lesson, do not forget to subscribe to the channel and also press the bell icon. So without wasting any time, let's start with the session. We will be starting with certain factual questions and then I will be moving towards certain analytical questions. The first question, as you can see, is as per interim budget 2019-20. So this clears the doubt whether interim budget is important for the examination or not. Yes, it is very important for the examination, especially phase 1 of NABARD 2019. I am expecting 5 to 10 questions, at least 5 questions from the budget directly in this particular exam. The question is, as per interim budget 2019-20, how much interest rebate is to be provided to MSME sector companies taking loans up to 1 crore? One more information which is connected is that these companies which want to be eligible for this interest tax, interest rebate, have to be enrolled in GST structure as well. And if they want to take a loan up to 1 crore, they will be provided an interest rebate of up to 2%. So this is a purely factual question, which I believe you should be able to remember. Another way this particular question can be framed is, how much loan can they take? What is the loan ceiling for MSMEs applying for interest rebate and at the same time enrolled in GST structure? Well, the answer to that will be 1 crore. Let's go to the next question. Which of the following is the main objective behind PM Kisan? First of all, let me ask you, what is the full form of Kisan? If you know it, please write it in the comment section below. You can pause the video now. Let me tell you the full form of Kisan. Kisan Samman Nidhi. Kisan Samman Nidhi. That is the full form of PM Kisan, Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi. What is the central objective of Kisan Samman Nidhi? I have framed a very small question, but the purpose is to ensure that you understand the objectives of these schemes which have been launched recently. This was also launched very recently. The options are interest subvention to farmers for agricultural loans, number one. Providing value-added services to farmers to supplement their income, number two. Ensuring guaranteed income to small and marginal farmers, number 3, and providing NAM to Kisan to double farmers income by 2022. Let us try and eliminate options one by one. NAM to Kisan to double farmers income by 2022 looks very promising. Ensuring guaranteed income to small and marginal farmers again looks promising. Providing value-added services to farmers to supplement their income. What kind of value-added services can the government provide to farmers to supplement their income? Looks very incorrect on the face of it. Interest subvention to farmers for agricultural loan. The purpose of Kisan Samman is not interest subvention. The purpose of Kisan Samman is to provide certain basic income support to farmers, basic income support to farmers, so that they can use this income at the time of harvesting or at the time of sowing the crops. So the answer is ensuring guaranteed income to small and marginal farmers. Let's come to the next question. PMSYM has been introduced for workers of unorganized sector. Which of the following is the main objective of setting up PMSYM? Okay, I am not going to tell you the full form of PMSYM. I want you to write the correct answer in the comment section below so that I know how many of you know the answers. What is the main objective of setting up PMSYM? Converting unorganized sector jobs to organized sector jobs. Providing pension to workers of unorganized sectors for social security. Providing free health insurance to poor households of unorganized sector. Providing collateral free loans up to rupees 2 lakh for workers of unorganized sector. Well, the answer to this question is pension to workers of unorganized sector for social security, where the maximum pension can be up to rupees 3000 per month after that worker turns 60 years of age. Okay, more on these schemes have already been discussed in the schemes documents which have already been released and provided to the enrolled students. So the answer is providing pension to workers of unorganized sector for social security. Next question is, which of the following sets of companies are eligible for reduced corporate tax rate of 25%? Again, this has been picked up from interim budget where the corporate tax rate has been reduced. The options are domestic companies with turnover below 500 crore, a purely factual question. Domestic and MNCs with turnover below 250 crore. Domestic and MNCs with turnover below 500 crore. And domestic companies with turnover below rupees 250 crore. You have to remember that it is eligible only for domestic companies and their turnover ceiling is 250 crore. So the answer is D, domestic companies with turnover below or equal to 250 crore to be accurate. Next question, which of the following correctly explains democratization of credit? Two very important terms that certainly will be asked as per me in the RBI examination and high chances of them being asked in NABARD grade B also. At the same time, because financial inclusion forms a part of ESI as well, they might be asked in NABARD grade A as well. Democratization of credit and financialization of savings. Democratization of credit and financialization of savings. These two terms, you have to understand the meanings of them. Let's go through the options. Availability of credit to all based on consistent flow of payments data for underwriting individual credit. So number one keyword is availability of credit to all. Intensive flow of investment avenues to the bottom of the pyramid. Flow of investment avenues. Innovations in financial sector to design better products for more options to the investor. Design better product innovations in financial sector. Availability of only one credit per person to ensure access of credit to all. One credit per person. This certainly looks wrong because although the meaning of democracy is one vote, one per person, but providing only one credit per person in order to ensure that everybody has access to credit does not make any sense. Okay, because providing credit to me does not stop the financial institution or a bank from providing credit to you. And therefore, one credit per person is certainly wrong. Innovations in financial sector and investment flow of investment avenues, both are related to financial sector. And therefore, democratization of credit does not belong to that. So the answer is availability of credit to all, which again is the meaning of democracy to a certain sense. Okay. So the answer is availability of credit to all based on consistent flow of payments data to underwriting individual credit. The next question is also similar, but it asks about financialization of savings. So you might be confused between B and C now. The options are the same. Intensive flow of investment avenues to the bottom of the pyramid. Innovations in banking sector. Now it talks about innovations in banking sector to design better products for more saving options to the depositor. Now the reason that I've changed the third option is because both these options B and C are features of financialization of savings. The purpose of financialization of savings is to provide better investment avenues to people, to investors, so that they can financialize their savings, they can better invest their savings. And one of the objectives of financialization of savings is also to enhance the reach of financialization of savings so that the bottom of the population pyramid, which is basically poor people or poor in the middle class, who can take advantage of these initiatives. Which of the following SDG pertains to good governance? A very factual question. The answer is SDG 16. I have already discussed all the SDGs one by one, a total of 17 SDGs, and all of them have been discussed along with their targets. UN has given 8 pillars of good governance. Which of the following is not one of them? Now, I have created an acronym in order for you to remember the 8 pillars of good governance given by UN. The acronym is College Education and Rote Learning are put together, wherein college is consensus oriented. Education has two meanings. Number one is effectiveness and efficiency, and number two is inclusion, equitable and inclusion. Then we have rote, that is R. R stands also for two things, responsiveness, number one, and rule of law, number two. So responsiveness, let me write it down. Responsiveness and rule of law. Okay. Then you have learning, which has no meaning, and that's why L is small. The letter L is small. R put together, A stands for accountable. A stands for accountable. Put, P stands for participative, and T together stands for transparency. So by learning this acronym or this Joomla, you can actually learn the entire, all the 8 pillars of good governance as per UN. College education and rote learning are put together. That's the Joomla, or that's the short term you can remember in order to remember 8 pillars. So the answer to this question is very easy. It's not transparency. It's not consensus oriented. It's not efficiency and effectiveness. It's not accountability. It's not participation. It is accessibility. A stands for accountability and not accessibility. If you had just tried to mug up all the 8 pillars, probably you would forget them. But by using this, you have higher chances of remembering it and recalling it in the future as well. A very important question, according to DISHA, which stands for Digital Information Security in Healthcare Act, a lot of questions can be framed from this. Which of the following is to be considered sensitive information? HIV status of 2 individuals, abortion history of individuals, use of psychotropic and narcotic substances by individuals, and history of mental disorders. All kinds of sexual, / physical, and mental, / psychological issues related with individuals. Informations related with these 2, which includes everything that a person might have, every kind of disease or disorder that a person might have, is a part of Digital Information Security in Healthcare Act, which ensures or wants to ensure that personal information of individuals is not leaked to the public or leaked to individuals, other private organizations without that person's consent. So the answer to this question is A, all are correct, because all of them have been and are being considered as sensitive information as per DISHA. So this was all about today's discussion, where we took up a lot of questions based on Yojana and Kurukshetra for March 2019. Very soon, I will also be discussing questions from February 2019 of both Yojana and Kurukshetra. If you like the lesson, please subscribe to the channel and also press the bell icon. All the very best. Take care.